Hey guys, Reese here, and welcome back to another video. So today we're gonna be talking about the question when it comes to real estate, cash flowing real estate, right? And that is exactly how much should my rental property cash flow? Especially that question is asked a lot when, you know, analyzing a new deal, if it's a good deal. And on the surface, that sounds like it's a very simple question, right? Like I could tell you, oh, 100 bucks a month per unit, video's over, see you guys later, right? However, while it's a simple question, it's not that straightforward. So for example, what if I asked you guys, hey, my rental property cash flow is $500 a month. Is that a good deal? I hope you guys would tell me, well, you don't know, right? Because there's not enough information yet. And so in today's video, we're going to talk about all the different facets and all the different information you need to know in order to determine exactly how much a rental property should cash flow. So guys, before we dive into that today, I'd love it if you would go ahead and like this video. And if you're new to the channel, please feel free to subscribe. I talk about mostly real estate content here. However, I will dip my toes into some other financial topics as we go along. So guys, thank you so much, and let's dive right into the video. So first off, let's talk about what cash flow is. I think that's probably pretty important for this video to understand exactly what cash flow is. So let's say you buy a duplex. You're going to have, of course, income on that property if you're, you know, renting it out. And so you'll have your rental income, which is the most common. However, you know, you might have laundry income, you might have utility income. All that income can be lumped together as your income. And then we're going to subtract off your expenses. So your PITI, which is your mortgage payment, your principal and interest, your taxes and insurance, as well as other repairs and capital expense escrows and management fees, things like that. I have a video about how to analyze a rental property for cash flow that I'll link up here if you want a more detailed analysis on that. However, that difference between income and expenses is your profit or your cash flow in this case. Now for all the numbers in this video, I'm going to be referring to what's called stabilized cash flow. So when you buy, especially 1 to 4 units, when you buy, say, a duplex, a 2-unit property, you might buy that property with substantially under market rents and therefore get a great deal on the property, but it won't be cash flowing just yet because you need to do a little bit of cosmetic fix up, maybe get out the old tenants, put in some new market rent paying tenants, and then you'll be cash flowing, and that'll be the stabilized cash flow. And this is one way you can get great deals, is by buying properties that have been mismanaged or just ignored and therefore have long-term tenants paying substantially under market rent. Okay, so let's get right down to it. What do we need to know in order to determine if a cash flow number is good or bad? Well, there's three things. The first one is you need to know your cash on cash return, and in turn, you know, in order to determine that, how much money was invested in the deal. And I think this might be something that newer investors overlook, is that, you know, $500 a month in cash flow seems like a lot of money, especially for somebody just getting started in real estate. That's $6,000 a year. However, if you have invested $100,000 into this deal between the down payment and maybe some minor cosmetic repairs and acquisition fees, things like that, well, that's only a 6% return, cash on cash return, which is the annual cash flow divided by the amount of money invested in the deal. Is that good or is that bad? We're not quite sure yet, right? We need to determine our investment criteria, which is super important when buying real estate, because buying real estate and making big purchases in general, you tend to get a little bit emotionally involved, right? So having your investment criteria on paper, super important. So my investment criteria is I want to see a 15% stabilized cash on cash return. A lot of people might settle for 10, and a lot of people in different markets, say California, well, you're going to have a substantially less cash on cash return with the hope that, you know, prices will appreciate and make up for the lack of cash flow. So if you determine a 10% cash on cash return is your minimum investment criteria, well, that $500 a month is no longer a good investment or a good cash flow because it's only 6% if you invested $100,000 in it. Now you can manipulate this cash on cash return by adjusting your financing terms. So say that was a 25% down loan. Can you do a 20% down loan, maybe a commercial loan? By putting less money down, you'll have a higher cash on cash return on average, even though you will be paying a little bit more principal and interest. So for example, when you use a higher leverage loan, like say an FHA loan, 3.5% down, well, it's very possible to see your cash on cash return jump up to 25% because you have almost no money in the deal. However, this exact scenario brings me to my next point on how to determine what is good cash flow for your rental property. And that is point number two, which is you need to set a minimum acceptable cash flow. This is another investment criteria that should be written down and you never really move away from it unless you've really thought about it. Personally, I will not buy an investment property if it does not have a stabilized cash flow of at least $100 per unit. So once again, say I buy a fourplex, well, I need to see that I have $400 a month in cash flow minimum. See, in my market specifically, it's not too difficult to find a property that I can put a 5% down payment on with a, you know, owner-occupied conventional loan. And therefore my cash-on-cash return, once I get rents raised and do some cosmetic renovations, will be 20, 25, 30%, right? And that might look like a great deal because you're like, holy cow, a 30% return every year on cash flow alone, not including, you know, appreciation, taxes, principal pay down. Well, when you look on the other side of things and look at your minimum acceptable cash flow per unit, you're only getting $40 a month per unit in cash flow because you're so highly leveraged, and yet it looks good because you have almost no money in the deal due to that super low down payment. And so what's super important here is that then you might adjust your financing. So you're doing 5% down. Well, maybe you should bring on a partner and put 25% down or 20% down, whatever. And that way you'll have a smaller principal and interest payment, and therefore your cash flow will go up substantially. Your return will go down probably, you know, from say 30 down to 15%. However, you have to play that fine line between manipulating your financing, your amount of money in the deal, and the deal itself to get it so that you meet your minimum cash flow and you meet your minimum cash on cash return. See, what happens if the market tanks and you lose a tenant because they lose their job and you can't re-rent your property at those previously defined market rents? Well, if you only have $40 a month in cash flow per unit, you can only drop your rent down by $40 until you're break even to get a tenant in the door, right? However, $100 per month minimum cash flow gives you that buffer to say, hey, I'm gonna drop my rent down $100 a month, which is huge in most markets, and get a tenant in the door, a good tenant renting, and therefore your break even, you can weather the storm of that bad market. Or one other example, what if you have 1 month that has higher expenses than normal? Say you have a $75 repair that comes out of nowhere that's on top of your already budgeted repair expenses. Well, if you only have $40 a month in cash flow, you're coming out of pocket to cover that expense. Whereas $100, once again, would cover that $75 expense. Now, of course, $100 is not the end-all be-all, but it's the amount of money I've set in my minimum investment criteria to be a large enough buffer that I'm comfortable with it. And that $100 helps me make sure I'm not over-leveraging my deals. You know, it's said that a great deal can be ruined by bad debt on that property. And that's because you over-leverage and put bad debt, high interest debt on a property, it can kill the deal and make it unsustainable. So that's one way I keep myself in check by not over-leveraging my deals. And finally, the third thing I look for when analyzing cash flow on a rental property is how much value add is there on that property and how much effort is there to get there. And this is really the last big thing I look for when determining if this property has enough cash flow on it, or comparing deals that I analyze. Is there value add? Is there forced appreciation? And how much work will it take to get there? So I've talked about this before, but I'm a big fan of the BRRRR investment strategy, which means I'm going to buy properties and do minor cosmetic renovations on them. I'll re-rent them at a higher market rent and then refinance them, pull that cash out to then buy another property. Well, if that property has no value add on it, then even if it hits my minimum investment criteria we talked about earlier, I probably would not buy it still. I might, as a real estate agent, try to sell it to somebody else, but I probably would not personally buy it because I need that value add aspect. See, if you have a bigger portfolio and you have a lot more money coming in than I do, you would probably still buy that deal because it meets your minimum cash flow requirements. However, for me, I have limited funds, as a lot of other people do when they're starting off in real estate. And so if I put all my money into a deal that has my minimum cash flow and minimum cash on cash return, well, now I have no more money to buy another deal, right? So I need to be able to add value, pull that money back out to continue investing into new properties. In addition, what if, you know, we've been talking about stabilized cash flow. What if you can buy a property, but it's going to take major work, you know, foundation repairs, structural issues. What if it takes a lot of effort to get it that stabilized cash flow? We're still taking into account that you're going to have to invest $100,000 to get this property, you know, renovated and stabilized, right? However, if there's a lot more risk associated with that renovation because it's not a cosmetic renovation, such as, you know, foundation repairs, structural repairs, maybe it's not worth it for you anymore because of the risk associated with the renovation and the amount of time it's going to take to get that property stabilized and cash flowing at that 15%. We use this to weigh kind of the risk versus reward. However, don't let this stress you out at all, guys. So when you're first getting started in real estate, you can really just focus on the first step, you know, cash on cash return. How much is my cash on cash return from this property? Say you're going to house hack, which means you live in one side of, say, a duplex and rent out the other. Well, you're probably gonna put 5% down on it, and you might only hit your 10% cash on cash return, but because you have so little money in the deal, you know, it only cash flows 50 bucks per side. Well, it's one deal, you still have your W-2 job, you know, you're getting your feet wet. Just worry about hitting your cash on cash return without overextending yourself on the debt side. Then on that second property you buy, maybe consider the first 2 points, which is your cash on cash return and your minimum cash flow required. And then the third deal, bring it all together. You've gotten your feet wet and you've not stressed yourself out with all three of these points trying to find a great deal, and therefore you never buy a deal because you don't find one that matches. So guys, thank you so much for watching this video today. I really appreciate all your support. Once again, go ahead and like this video and subscribe if you're new to the channel. I really appreciate it. So thanks again, guys, and I'll see you all in the next video. Have a great day.